आई होप कि अब मेरी आवाज़ जो है वो आप सबको क्लियर हो रही क्लियर आ रही होगी। जैसे मैं नेम इज डॉक्टर फरीहा फाले। आई हैव डन माई ग्रेजुएशन एंड मास्टर्स इन न्यूरोलॉजिकल फिजिकल थेरेपी फ्रॉम द यूनिवर्सिटी ऑफ लाहौर। एंड करेंटली आई एम टीचिंग एज लेक्चरर इन यूनिवर्सिटी ऑफ लाहौर एंड डूइंग माई क्लिनिकल प्रैक्टिस एट माई मेडिकल सेंटर विच इज सिचुएटेड इन जोहर टाउन लाहौर। सो आई एम थैंकफुल टू हेल्थ जो एसोसिएशन फॉर इनवाइटिंग मी फॉर दिस वेबिनार। So basically, before understanding what is neurodynamics, what does it mean, how does it work, we should be familiar with the basic neuroanatomy, neurophysiology, and after understanding the basic neuroanatomy and neurophysiology, you will be able to understand that how our nerve mechanics work and what are the different neuropathologies through which neuropathologies which we can treat through neurodynamics. So basically, first you have to get the concept of neuroanatomy and neurophysiology. So I guess this is the diagram you are seeing from in your biology book from Macri. So this is basically the structure of a neuron, which is a structural and functional unit of nervous system. Basically, nervous system is a unique system and it controls all the other systems. So being a physiotherapist, we think that the musculoskeletal system is the most important system which we can deal, we can treat, manage, etc. But mainly the musculoskeletal system is controlled by the nervous system. The messages our brain are creating, the different information, receiving the different sensation and responding to that. So basically, nervous system is a unique system because it controls all the other systems. आई होप कि मेरी आवाज़ अब जो है वो आप लोगों को क्लियर होगी क्योंकि आई एम स्पीकिंग वेरी लाउड एंड इफ यू कांट हियर देन प्लीज चेक योर मोबाइल वॉल्यूम और लैपटॉप वॉल्यूम। Is my voice is clear now? So if you are having some issue, then please check maybe your mobile or laptop voice volume is low. So kindly check it. So we will continue the topic. So basically, the nervous system is a unique system because it controls all the other systems. And the basis of nervous system is formed by neuron. Neuron is the structural and functional unit of the nervous system. Neuron is different from all the other cells of the body, as you can see in this diagram that it has projection called dendrites and axon, which make it unique from the all the other cells of the body. These projections are responsible for receiving information and conveying them to the next neuron. Basically, neuron is present in a chain. The axon, which you are seeing here, is present in a chain connecting with one another. And this forms the nerve fiber. So basically, axon is covered with myelin sheath, which help in increasing the velocity of conduction. There is one more uniqueness of the neuron, that the cell body of neuron does not contain centrosome. Centrosome is the organelle which help in cell division, the mitosis and meiosis. So basically, if a neuron does not have centrosome, it means that the cell of neuron can't undergo division, can't divide it into two. Here is the next diagram. If you can see on the top that there is an axon. Different neuron axons combine in a chain and this basically form a nerve fiber. The picture you are seeing on the top is the nerve fiber, and nerve fiber is basically covered with the connective tissue layering, which is known as endoneurium, as you can see in this diagram. The bundles of basically, I will repeat that again, that the axons make a chain and this chain is known as a nerve fiber. Nerve fiber, basically, you know that the axon is covered with a special sheath called myelin sheath, which help in insulation and increase the conductivity of impulse. So basically, the nerve fiber is made up of axon, and nerve fiber is covered with a connective tissue which is known as endoneurium. The bundles of nerve fibers are then collectively present in another covering which is known as perineurium, and this bundle is basically known as the fascicles. So basically the axons are forming the nerve fiber, and the bundles of nerve fibers are combinedly forming the fascicles, and the fascicles are different bundles of fascicles are collectively called as nerve, and it is covered with a sheath known as actineurium. So before understanding what neurodynamic is and how does it work, you should be familiar with endoneurium, perineurium and actineurium. The endoneurium is the layer of a nerve fiber, is the covering of nerve fiber, and it is a connective tissue. And the bundles of nerve fibers are present in perineurium, and this is known as a fascicle. And the bundle of fascicle is present in epineurium, and this is known as a nerve. So this is a cross section of nerve. And here you can see the blood vessels. So these are the micro blood vessels that are supplying the nerve. So here is another diagram. So here is another diagram which is showing the same structure, that this is showing a spinal nerve which is arising from a spinal cord. And you can see here very clearly that there are axons covered with myelin sheath, and they are further covered with a connective tissue which we called as endoneurium. Endoneurium is basically covering of nerve fibers. Then there come fascicles, which is the collection of nerve fiber, and its covering is known as perineurium. And the bundles of perineurium or fascicles are collected in another connective tissue which is known as epineurium. So basically, these connective tissue are called as the neural tissue. And basically, the purpose of neurodynamics, it is to mobilize these tissues, the adhesion forms in this tissue or the disturbance in this tissue which leads to the dysfunction or pain. So basically, neurodynamics help in the mobilization of this neural tissue, which is epineurium, endoneurium and perineurium. So here is a structure which is showing the different divisions. There are two divisions of a nervous system, central nervous system and peripheral nervous system. Central nervous system contains brain and spinal cord. And the peripheral nervous system is basically the peripheral nerves which are originating from the central nervous system. So we can say that the core or the central part of central nervous system is basically the brain and spinal cord, and the peripheral nerves are originating from it. The peripheral nervous system is originating from it. The nerves originate from brain are known as the cranial nerve, and the nerves originate from the spinal cord are known as spinal nerves. So basically, if there is any neurological disorder in brain and spinal cord, it can disturb peripheral nerves as well. For example, today our topic is upper limb neurodynamics. So let's talk about the cervical radiculopathy. In cervical radiculopathy, the nerve becomes pinched, and this leads to the disturbance in the peripheral nerves. For example, median, radial and ulnar nerve, depending upon the area, depending upon the segment which is pinched. So basically, peripheral nervous system is an extension of central nervous system. At central nervous system is the core of nervous system which contains brain and spinal cord. So further here come another connective tissue which are meninges. So basically, as you all already know, that the central nervous system is protected by three layers, three coverings, which are known as meninges, which are pia mater, arachnoid mater and dura mater. So basically, these coverings are also a neural tissue. So mobilization can also, basically in neurodynamics, we can also mobilize these coverings, which are present in spinal cord. So basically, the neural tissue contains the covering which are epineurium, perineurium, endoneurium, and also the meninges. Meninges are the protective layers that cover brain and spinal cord. Here is another diagram. The purpose of this diagram is to show you the nerve roots. As you can see, the nerve roots, the nerves, basically the spinal nerves are arising from the spinal cord, and this arising is basically the nerve root. As you can see, the nerve root contains, basically nerve root is further protected by another layer, which is dura mater. So if a person's nerve is mobilized or tested, then there is some mobilization in the dura mater. So basically nerve root is covered by dura mater, which is an extension of the dura mater present on spinal cord. So you should clear all these concepts, that basically what is a nervous system, what are its divisions, and how does it work. So you can easily able to understand that how does neurodynamics work. So let's talk about what is neurodynamics. Neurodynamics is basically a broad category in which we can assess that is there is any disturbance, dysfunction in the neural tissue, and it also contains its treatment. So neurodynamics is, you can say that neurodynamics is divided into two categories. One is the diagnostic, that you test is there any disturbance, dysfunction in the neural tissue, and the second one is the therapeutic, the treatment of the disturbance or the sign or symptoms present. So basically neurodynamics is a broad category which contains the assessment and the treatment of neural tissue. So basically neurodynamics is the science of relationship between mechanics and the physiology of nervous system, that what is the function of nervous system and how does the nervous system mechanics work. So its association, the mobility and the function of nervous system association is linked with neurodynamics. So basically, as I already told you, that the nervous system is divided into central nervous system and peripheral nervous system. So central nervous system is the core from which the peripheral nervous system originates. And peripheral nervous system is basically the 12 pairs of cranial nerves and the 31 pairs of spinal nerves. And the peripheral nervous system, as you already know, is further divided into autonomic nervous system and somatic nervous system. Here we will talk about the somatic nervous system. The anatomy of autonomic nervous system is quite different from this. So here we are talking about, mainly talking about the neurodynamics of peripheral nerve, which are the somatic nerves. So I already told you that neurodynamics is a broad category. It contains the diagnostic test and the therapeutic treatment. So if anyone want to assess, if you want to assess the nervous system of a person or a patient, first you do a neural examination, which is a traditional examination that you check about what part he is feeling, numbness, tingling, paresthesia, etc. You check that. So you check about the myotomes, dermatomes, reflexes. So this is the neural examination, traditional neural examination. Beside this, you can also check that is there any issue in the mobility of nerve, in the neural mobility. So neurodynamics assessment is basically a part of examination of nervous system, through which you can examine different peripheral nerves. So what is basically a neurodynamic assessment? So neurodynamic assessment is basically, it enables us to check the length and the mobility of nerves. So basically we can check the length and the mobility by providing tension to the nervous system, by providing or creating tension in the peripheral nerves. So basically these are divided into two tests, upper limb tension test and lower limb tension test. If we are checking the upper extremity nerves, such as the median, radial, ulnar nerve, musculoskeletal nerve, axillary nerve, then these are upper limb tension tests. And if we are checking about the striatic, femoral nerve, tibial nerve, etc., posterior tibial nerve, then we are checking the lower limb test. So basically today's our topic is upper limb test. So I hope you got the clear idea that what the neurodynamic is. Basically, neurodynamic, I will repeat again, neurodynamic is a broad category. It contains the diagnosis and the therapeutic. Mean you can check the neural tissue and you can treat it. So basically, neurodynamic assessment is the diagnostic part, and neurodynamic mobilization, or also known as neural mobility, is basically the therapeutic part. So basically, you can self-assess yourself. So take a brief break and check that how much you learned from this questions. Please take 2 to 3 minutes and try to answer these questions so you can check that how much you have learned from this webinar till now. So I hope you have done your self-assessment. Now we will continue further. Now we will go for the upper limb tension tests. So basically, upper limb tension tests were first known as brachial plexus tension test, as they were discovered by a scientist LV. So they are also known as LV test. So if you listen somewhere, LV test, brachial plexus test, upper limb tension test, so these all tests are same. And there is one more name that they are also known as nerve provocation test. As if a person's neural tissue is disturbed, then these provoke the neural symptoms. That the person is feeling numbness, pain, paresthesia, then these tests will provoke these symptoms. So basically, in upper limb tension test, the various joints and bones, the various parts of the upper extremity are placed in a specific position so that the stress or the tension in the nerve is maximum. And if by applying stress or by creating stress or tension aggravates the symptom, then this indicates that there is involvement of neural tissue or neural system in the patient's symptoms, in the dysfunction of patient. So here is another important component of the tension test, whether it is upper limb or lower limb. It is known as sensitizer, or somewhere basically sensitizer is a part that if you have created a tension in a nerve, sensitizer is a part that if you do, or if you do the movement of that joint, it is very sensitive that it will further create the tension in the nerve. So basically, sensitizer, you can also say that it is a structure which can help us to differentiate that of that whether it is due to a musculoskeletal system or whether this is due to a neural tissue disorder. That the symptoms patient is facing is the due to the musculoskeletal disorder, or basically it is due to the neural tissue disorder. So basically, we will discuss with example that basically what is sensitizer. So sensitizer, keep that in mind, it is the movement of a joint which further aggravates or provoke the symptoms. by which we can differentiate that if the system involved is musculoskeletal or neural. So basically, first you have to know that why do we do upper limb tension test, lower limb tension test. So basic concept for upper limb, lower limb is same. So basically, we do these tests for, if we talk about the upper extremity, then we do these tests to check that if there is any disturbance in neural tissue or not. By these tests, we can check about the cervical radiculopathy, that if any nerve is pinched in the cervical region, then these can be checked by upper limb tension test. And for checking the symptoms and the nerve involved, you should be familiar with the dermatomes and myotomes. Due to the shortage of time, I didn't include it in this, but you should be familiar with the dermatomes and myotomes that a specific nerve or spinal nerve would supply which skin area and which muscle, by which you can easily differentiate that if a person is feeling pain or symptoms in this region, then this can be due to this spinal root or spinal nerve. So basically, you should be familiar with dermatomes and myotomes in order to evaluate a person's nervous system. So I already told you that these systems are diagnostic and therapeutic. They are used to check the nervous system and they are also used in treatment. So basically, what is the basic method by which we can assess the different peripheral nerves by creating tension? So basically, first, if a person is feeling pain in the right side, then first you have to check the neurological examination. You must do the neurological examination of the left side. So first basic principle is that when you are going to apply or do the neural tension test, you have to check the normal or the asymptomatic side first. And after checking, you will go for the symptomatic side, which is affected side, and you will compare both extremities, left or right, upper limb, left or right, you will compare both. And if by comparison you will make that, is its neural tissue or nerve is disturbed or not, by comparing. So basically, if we talk about the upper limb tension test, so there is a basic order that you should do this joint movement first, followed by respective joints. So if you are checking about the upper limb, you should first do the shoulder movement, followed by the forearm movement. Forearm movement means its supination or pronation. Wrist movement, finger, whether flexion or extension. And lastly, you will go for the elbow. So you can, if patient has too much neurological disorder, so by moving elbow at last, you will easily able to understand that patient is having neurological disorder or not. So basically, this is the order that first you should move shoulder, followed by forearm, and then you will go for the movement of wrist and finger, and lastly the elbow. For all the nerves, the movements are different. So here we can't specify that we will do shoulder abduction, internal rotation or external rotation. And for forearm, we can't specify. So basically, this is the concept or order of joint movement, that first you should move shoulder, then forearm, wrist, fingers, and lastly the elbow. And if the patient does not have pain or any issue, then you can add the sensitizer component. And in upper limb, the sensitizer component is side flexion of cervical spine, that you can add same side or opposite side of cervical spine flexion. So basically, how we apply this cervical spine flexion, we will discuss it in the demo part, which will be after the end of this session. So I will explain you how we can add the cervical spine and how we can differentiate that this is basically the neural tissue involvement. And if in any initial movement, for example, when you have move the shoulder, forearm, wrist, fingers in a specific position, and if you are moving, for example, let's suppose you are extending the elbow, if patient feel pain in the starting range, then you will not go for the further examination and you will not add the sensitizer component. You will stop at the point patient felt pain or symptom, or his symptoms are increased. So you will stop at that point. Now, what is the interpretation of the test we perform, the upper extremity tension test? What is the interpretation? If the patient symptoms aggravate, if the neurological symptoms of patient, for example, numbness, tingling, pain, aggravates by applying tension in nerve, so it means the neural structure is involved. And to what limit an extremity can move? For example, if shoulder, elbow, for example, let me take the elbow example. For example, in the first initial degree of the elbow extension, patient felt pain. It means that the mechanical interference in neural structure is quite much. So by the degree of movement, you can find the mechanical interference or the dysfunction of neural structure. So here go the self-assessment too. Please check up these questions, that are you able to understand these questions or not. Then we will go to the last part, which is basically the practical part. So now the break time is over. Let's start the practical part. From the comment, I have seen that many of you did not understand exactly about what a sensitizer is. So basically, I will explain in this practical portion about the sensitizer. Sensitizer is also known as structural differentiation. It helps to differentiate whether the pain or the symptoms patient is having is due to the neurological dysfunction or due to the involvement of musculoskeletal system. So basically, the sensitizer, also known as structural differentiation, helps to differentiate between the involvement of musculoskeletal system or the neural system. So let's talk about the median nerve. So before applying the neurodynamics, how do we assess it, how we can apply tension, you should be familiar with the root of the median nerve. So as in this diagram, you can see that median nerve is basically nerve which is present in upper extremity, and it arises from the C5 to C7 spinal roots. So basically C5 to C7 spinal root impingement can provoke symptoms in neural in median nerve. So basically, if in this picture you can see that if you see your palm, so the thumb, index finger, middle finger and half ring finger is supplied by the median nerve. Thumb, index finger, middle finger and half ring finger, as you can see on the top of the picture, is supplied by the median nerve. If a patient is feeling symptoms, numbness, tingling, the weakness of thoracic muscle wasting in this area, then this means that the median nerve is involved. You should check for the median nerve. You should check for the spinal root C5 to C7. So basically, and how you can assess that these areas supplied by median nerve by knowing the dermatomes and myotomes. So you should know that what are dermatomes? Dermatomes are basically the nerve area of skin supplied by a single spinal root. And myotomes are basically the group of muscles supplied by a single spinal root. So you should be able to understand that which nerve is involved by knowing about the dermatomes and the myotomes. So basically where how median nerve can be disturbed or how this symptoms in median nerve can be provoked. There are syndromes such as CTS, you all will be familiar that in the anterior side of it, there is a tunnel present which is known as carpal tunnel, and median nerve passes through it. If the median nerve entraps in this, then this can provoke symptoms. So the second is post-colis fracture. Post-colis fracture is basically the fracture of distal part of radius near to the wrist. So if there is the fracture in the distal part of the wrist, then these can also provoke the symptoms of the median nerve, can lead to the involvement of the median nerve. And last, the C5 to C7 nerve root through which the median nerve is arising. So these are the common entrapments and syndrome which can lead to the dysfunction of median nerve. So here is a picture by which you can see that how we can do or we can apply tension in the median nerve. So I will go slowly with this, then we will do the demonstration of this. So basically, for tension test of median nerve, first you have to do the patient position should be spine, and whether it is median, radial or ulnar nerve. The patient position, best patient position is spine. But if the patient can't lie or you can't do in spine, then you can also go for sitting. But it requires much more control. So basically, the first thing is that you have to depress the patient's shoulder. I will go slowly one by one that how we can create tension and how we can do the upper limb tension test for the median nerve, which is also known as upper limb tension test 1. So how we can do that? First step is patient position is spine. Second step is, as you can see in this picture, that the hand of the therapist is depressing the shoulder. The second is to depress the shoulder. Third step in the median nerve tension test is to abduct the arm 110 degree. As you can see, that the arm of the patient is 110 degree abducted. Further, you have to go with the flexion of elbow, that the patient position and the elbow should be at flexion of 90 degrees. Then you will laterally rotate the shoulder and extend wrist and fingers. And then slightly you will extend the elbow. If patient feels pain and extending the elbow, then you will not perform the further test. And you will keep the elbow flexed, and you will apply the sensitizer part, which is basically the cervical side flexion. This will be more clear in the demo part. So I am just telling you about the movement, so you can be aware that what will be the position of the upper extremity to mobilize, to basically create tension in the median nerve, to create tension in the ulnar nerve. So basically, this is just a brief introduction that what will be the position. After that, we will go for the demo part. I will repeat again that for the median nerve, the first the patient position is supine. Therapist will depress the shoulder and then will abduct the arm 110 degree, and then the elbow will be flexed to 90 degree because we will add the elbow component at the end, if you remember the order. Then shoulder lateral rotation will be done and wrist and finger will be in extension. Then slowly the patient elbow will be extended and check for the symptoms. And the sensitizer part in upper extremity tension test, whether it is median nerve, radial nerve or ulnar nerve, it is the cervical side flexion or rotation. Next is the radial nerve. So basically, the radial nerve supplies the dorsal part of the hand, which is the thumb, middle ring finger, middle finger. So basically, these are supplied by the radial nerve. The dorsal part of the hand, the dorsal part of thumb, index finger, middle finger is supplied by the radial nerve, and its root value is C5 to T1. So how radial nerve can be involved and how it can disturb? So basically, in decorient syndrome, you know, in decorient syndrome or decorient tenosynovitis, the hand, the muscles of the forearm disturb. If there is inflammation or tenosynovitis, then this can lead to the disturbance in radial nerve. Second is the tenus elbow, which is also known as lateral epicondylitis, and if a patient have tenus elbow, then it can lead to the pain and the distribution of radial nerve. Next is post humeral fracture, and if a person has a humeral fracture, then this is very common cause of radial palsy. And next is the root, spinal root, which is basically the C5 and C6. If there is entrapment, if there is an issue pinching of nerve of these spinal root, then this can lead to the neural symptoms or radial nerve palsy. Now discuss about the position, that how we can apply stress in the radial nerve. So basically, first is the same, that we will depress the shoulder. Second is the slight abduction of arm, which is almost 10 degree. Then we will flex the elbow at 90 degree, because according to the order, we have to apply or add the elbow movement at the end. After that, we will go for the pronation of forearm and the flexion of wrist and fingers. So now you can see that the radial nerve is passing from the dorsal side. How we can apply tension or stretch in this nerve? By flexing the arm. And median nerve was passing from the anterior side, and how we can apply the stress? By extending the arm. And last is we will slowly add the elbow extension. If patient feel pain in elbow extension, then we will not go further. And same, the sensitizer in this movement is, the sensitizer in this movement is basically the same, cervical side flexion and rotation. Last is the ulnar nerve. Ulnar nerve is the nerve which supply the ring finger and the little finger. So if patient is feeling symptom in this area, then it shows the involvement of the ulnar nerve. So ulnar nerve can be entrapped in two areas, Gein's canal, it is present on the wrist. And the second is cubital tunnel, which is present on the posterior side of the elbow. So the ulnar nerve can be entrapped in these two areas. So how we can do the upper limb tension test for the ulnar nerve? So we will see that ulnar nerve root value is C8 to T1. So if a patient nerve spinal root C8 to T1 is impinged, then this can also lead to symptoms in the ulnar nerve. Next, the same first step is depress the shoulder. Then there will be the abduction of shoulder 90 degree. 90 degree abduction of the shoulder and the pronation. After the pronation, the wrist and the fingers will be extended, leading to the slight lateral rotation of the shoulder. And after that, the patient's fingers will be moved towards the ear. So this is how the ulnar nerve tension test is done. Almost our lecture is over, then we will go for the demonstration. But there is one more thing I want to explain as the neuromobilization or neural mobility. So basically, neural mobilization or neural mobility or neurodynamic mobility or mobilization, these are all the same thing as it being the therapeutic effect of neurodynamics, that the treatment we can do to treat the neurological disorder or the neural cancer. So neuromobilization is basically the mobilization of neural tissue, which we have discussed. Neural tissue was basically the epineurium, perineurium and endoneurium and the meninges. So basically the mobilization of these three layers of nerve and the meninges in order to treat different neurological dysfunction is known as neuromobilization, neurodynamic mobilization or neural mobility. So this was our today lecture. Now this is the last self-assessment, so you can assess yourself, and after that we will go for the demonstration part. As you know, this is a short duration webinar, so further can't be explained that how we can do the neural mobilization. So inshallah, further webinars will be conducted that how we can do the neural mobilization, as this is not a 1 hour lecture, so we can't cover everything in 1 hour. So this was the basically the neural assessment part. And one thing I want to share, that in neural examination and treatment, if you perform a test one time, it is the assessment. And if you perform that test multiple times or repeated times, it becomes its treatment. Same goes for the neural assessment and neural mobilization. If you are performing the tension test one time, then it is neural assessment. And if you repeatedly perform this test in a pattern, then it becomes the neural mobilization. I hope this is clear. I will share a performa for the feedback. Please fill that performa so we can know that if it was informative for you or not. I want to specially thanks to Dr. Muhammad Hussain Iqbal, who helped me in making this presentation or helping me, morally supporting me for giving this webinar. So I am very thankful to him. If you have any question related to this, you can comment.
अस्सलाम वालेकुम एवरीवन, आई एम डॉक्टर फरीहा खालिद. आई होप कि आप लोगों को अभी तक यू अंडरस्टैंड व्हाट इज़ न्यूरोडायनामिक्स, व्हाट इज़ न्यूरोमोबिलाइजेशन एंड हाउ वी कैन ट्रीट द प्रॉब्लम्स, हाउ वी कैन असेस. नाउ वी विल गो फॉर द डेमोन्स्ट्रेशन पार्ट. So for the upper limb tension test, first we will go for the median nerve. You have to do the parts in the order you have seen. You have to memorize the order. First there was the depression of the shoulder. As in lying position, spine position, you will not be able to see. So I am doing in a sitting position. So everyone has its own pattern to place hands as he is convenient. So I will place according to my conveniency. So now you can see that first for the median nerve, we have to depress the patient's shoulder. This is the depression. I have placed the hand on the patient's top shoulder and I will depress it by applying a downward pressure. So this is the depression. After doing the depression, we have to abduct the arm. This is abduction movement, sideways. So I will abduct the patient arm to 110 degree. After the abduction, now I will flex the elbow to the 90 degree. Okay, depression. So for my conveniency, I have depressed the elbow through my depressed the shoulder through my elbow. This is the depression part, and I have flexed the elbow. Shoulder is an abduction. So next, you have to laterally rotate the shoulder, and then you will perform the supination. Forearm supination and rotation. This is the position, and then you will go for the extension of fingers and wrist. This is the extension of fingers and wrist. And lastly, the last component was to move the elbow. So after making this position, shoulder is an abduction and external rotation, elbow is 90 degree flexed, wrist is forearm is in supination, and wrist and fingers are in extension. I will apply the elbow movement part, which is the elbow extension. This, if patient feel pain by extending the elbow, for example, let's suppose patient said that his symptoms are provoking, then I will not go any further. So if patient is not having symptoms, then I will check it. And this means patient has no symptoms. This means the neural part is not involved. Now, how I can add the sensitizer part, the structural differentiation part? I will ask the patient to do the side flexion on the opposite side. If you do the side flexion to the opposite side, there will be the maximum tension in the nerve. So if the symptom aggravates, this also shows that there is involvement of neural tissue. So do the side flexion. So if patient have pain, then this shows that neural structure is involved. So this was for the median nerve. You have to remember the pattern. You can perform on yourself so you can memorize it easily. So the pattern is basically the abduction of shoulder. This is the pattern. And if patient has to do that movement or to apply the sensitizer part, he will add the cervical side flexion component. Now we go for the radial nerve. For the radial nerve, same of the position that we will first depress the patient's shoulder. Second is, we will abduct his arm to the 10 degree. And next is, we will flex the elbow to the 90 degree. After that, we will do the pronation. And after doing the pronation, we will flex the patient wrist and finger. This is the flexion of patient wrist and finger. And after that, we will apply the elbow component, which is elbow extension part. If patient feels symptoms here, we will not go any further. Okay, I am applying the depression of shoulder to my elbow. So as I was rehearsing, I now have to control the whole extremity. So this is my pattern that I do this. So this is for the radial nerve. And same, you can apply the sensitizer part, which is the cervical flexion thing, as in the median nerve. So I will demonstrate. Always do the yourself so you can memorize this easily. For the radial nerve, the pattern is this. For the median nerve, the pattern was this. For the radial nerve, the pattern is this. Last is the ulnar nerve.
is the first position, first you have to depress the patient's shoulder, and second is the abduction. After abduction, you have to pronate the forearm, and after the pronation, you have to extend the wrist and fingers. Now you will flex the elbow. In median and radial nerve, you have to extend the elbow, while in ulna nerve, you have to flex the elbow. And you will move the patient fingers towards the ears. This movement. If patient feel pain, then you will not go further to this. And you can same add the cervical component, sensitizer part, which is this. This show that if the patient neural tissue is involved or not. So I will again demonstrate on myself. That for the median nerve, the pattern is this: shoulder abduction, shoulder abduction and external rotation, forearm supination, elbow extension, wrist and fingers extension. This is the pattern for the median nerve, and you can apply the sensitizer part by cervical flexion, side flexion. And next we talk about the radial nerve. For radial nerve, same are the position, but the forearm is in pronation and the wrist fingers are in flexion. And you can same at the cervical sensitizer part, which is the cervical side flexion. And last is the ulnar nerve. For the ulnar nerve, you will do the pronation of the forearm, shoulder abduction, wrist at the start, the elbow will be at extension, the forearm will be pronated and the wrist will be extended, and then you will flex the patient's elbow and bring the fingers towards the ears. This is for the median nerve, and you can add the sensitizer part by cervical side flexion. So this was the webinar and the demonstration. I hope it was clear to you. And please do give your feedback. The link will be shared in the WhatsApp groups. So if you have any question, you can ask. Or I will end the webinar as my patients are waiting. So all of you stay blessed. I love it.